Welcome to UO Today. I'm Paul Pepys, Director of the Oregon Humanities Center. My guest today is Richard York, Professor of Sociology and Environmental Studies at the University of Oregon. He's an environmental sociologist whose work combines human ecology and political economy. His research interests include how the structural characteristics of societies influence resource consumption and pollution emissions, the connections between animals and societies, and the sociology, philosophy, and history of science. Thanks, Richard, for coming on the show.
Thank you, Paul. I'm glad to be here.
So what sparked your interest in sociology and environmental studies? Where did that come from? How'd you get there?
Well, I should say, you know, interestingly, I grew up in Oregon mostly, which is unusual. I know for professors usually come from other places. And so I, you know, grew up in the 80s during a lot of the controversy over old growth logging, loss of the spotted owl. So I became really interested in environmental issues, particularly when I went to college. And I think one of the things I realized thinking about a lot of environmental problems is how ultimately there are socially generated problems. In a lot of ways, we tend to approach them as purely the science part, which is obviously extremely important. We have to understand the natural environment, what's happening there. But in the end, it's human decisions that determine what we're going to do. And so in that sense, I thought of environmental problems really are about how societies work, how decisions are made, issues of power, economics, and so forth. So I think that's what got me interested in looking at the social side of those. And I kind of had a meandering academic career that just kind of led me through different things. And I kind of discovered environmental sociology work when I was getting a master's in environmental studies. And that led me to kind of into the field.
So you've already begun to explain, but what is environmental sociology?
So generally, we just define it as the study of societal environmental interactions. And I think part of that I should note is, from the point of view of sociology, a lot of sociology, like a lot of the social sciences, did not necessarily have a strong tradition over the 20th century of considering the natural environment. It tended to be internal to social dynamics. And so part of the mission of environmental sociology was to tell sociologists that actually, you know, societies really are affected by the environment. And a lot of this emerged, you might not be surprised, in the 70s when you started to have all these energy crises. It became very, very apparent that societies were affected by natural resources, environmental limitations. So part of that was to say, if we're going to study societies, you need to understand their environmental context. And then, of course, the other side of that is to say, as I kind of started with on environmental problems, sociology has a lot to tell us if we want to solve environmental problems, because in the end, we really need to change something about how kind of societies operate.
So I'm going to ask you about some of your particular areas of research. So I know that one of your research works has studied what you and your co-authors call the curse of energy efficiency.
Yeah.
Why is energy efficiency a curse?
Yeah, that's a good question. It doesn't necessarily have to be, and I want to be clear on that, but I think we often too easily think of environmental problems as technical problems. So that's kind of our view, is we consume too much energy. If we become more efficient, all else being equal, we use less energy. Certainly a logic to that. The problem is how much we consume and produce is not independent of how efficient our technologies are. So actually historically what you find, and it is perverse and paradoxical, but it is often the case that when you get improvements in energy efficiency of production, you find you have more production, more energy use. That's actually, broadly speaking, the average trend of the industrial era. That's to say, 200 years ago, our machinery was much, much less efficient than it is today, but of course we consume much less energy. One of the ways I might explain that, I use often when I teach, is thought experiment. Mm-hmm. If you could imagine kind of two worlds, one in which you have all the cars are magically converted to very efficient cars, you know, maybe say something like a Toyota Prius, they get 50 miles to the gallon. And in an alternative world, you do the other extreme where all the cars are made super inefficient and say they take 50 gallons to go a mile. This is an extraordinary difference, a 2,500-fold difference. And kind of the thought experiment is, where would you use more energy? And you know, the nice thing about thought experiments is you could, you know, there's not falsifiable, so I have a little leeway to interpret that. But I think if you'd imagine a world in which a car took 50 gallons to go a mile, I really don't think we'd have a lot of car driving. I don't think we would have developed freeways and suburbs. We wouldn't have this massive sprawl. We wouldn't have expectations to drive everywhere. Biking would make more sense. Mass transit would make more sense. So in a way, part of how we've developed the world has something to do with actual efficiency. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't mean in any way that is a message that you should buy a Humvee or something, because I don't think on these immediate, we already have that infrastructure in place. It's the question of energy efficiency has rippling effects. I also think another way to think about it is, we often think all else equal, but in a sense, when you make something more energy efficient, in a sense, you make it more profitable per unit of energy you use, if you look at it that way. So there's actually an incentive to use more energy to make more production, consumption, and profits. Mm-hmm.
So if we truly want to reduce our dependence on oil and CO2 emissions, what ought we to do? How ought we to change our thinking and our behavior? Like if buying Priuses is not the solution.
Yeah, and I think that's, we need to focus more on kind of the production side and kind of side of decisions at the societal level. And that has a lot to do with looking more at power than consumer behavior. Mm-hmm. So that's the hard choice, but I think that means we need to shift away from these expectations of endless growth, the endless pursuit of profits. I mean, if I were to give an idealized view, is we should have more as a societal goal, something to do with improving people's quality of life, which isn't the same as making more stuff mm-hmm. for all of us to have. Mm-hmm. So I realize that's kind of a hard one to give, but I just say the problem I have thing when we think in terms of consumers, in some ways you could say the environmental problems happen because we're bad people who drive our cars and are lazy and we consume too much. But I would say if you think about it, why do you drive a car? It's not so much we love cars, it's because of our structure of our society, and in this sense, literal infrastructure, the way housing is laid out, the expectations for job performance, for where we have to go shopping to get food, where we have to take families for school or whatever. It's very hard to get around without a car. Mm-hmm. Where if you had a differently structured society, which you do in some dense urban centers, more common in Europe, there's different, you know, where there's dense urban centers, there's mass transit. It's not then so much the people in those areas have more virtue who make more green calculations. It's the structure of the decision making makes it less sensible to drive a car. So that'd just be one example of how we just even think about how consumers actually make choices. In fact, I even use that we even think of ourselves as consumers mm-hmm. is a whole other issue mm-hmm. instead of people who are trying to live lives. Mm-hmm.
So given what you've just said, what's your view on the value of green technologies? Is that a good thing? Should we be pursuing them?
So I have a mixed answer on that. Is I think there's definitely virtues to having them. It's the problem is not the technologies, it's the perceiving the problem as technological in mm-hmm, nature. Mm-hmm. So technologies can definitely be helpful, but they really have to do with how they're applied. So I would say something like some of my other research, not just efficiency, has looked at to the extent you get substitution when you, for example, add green energy. So solar power, wind power, does that push out fossil fuels? And I think there's a fair bit of evidence that it often more adds on top of it. Hmm. Now, that doesn't mean it has to. Mm-hmm. And so to give an obvious statement, if we're going to stop using fossil fuels, which I think we should mm-hmm. because of all their problems, you have to have some alternative energy source.
Right.
Of course you need then green technologies. We want sustainable technologies. The error in thinking is simply adding those technologies without making other changes will somehow naturally in a market push out fossil fuels. So I think that suggests we need a more kind of coherent effort to actively remove fossil fuels and shift to a different way of doing things rather than just hoping that technological innovation on its own will solve these problems.
Hmm. So I know another one of the areas you investigate, very interesting research is you've investigated the connection between women's political status mm-hmm. and CO2 emissions per capita. Mm-hmm. So tell us about that.
So you can see that kind of comes from a more sociological way of thinking of seeing connections in how societies have values and take actions. So I should say that's been a small part of my work, which I've really just done some exploratory analyses. But we have found that it tends to be, when you control for a lot of factors, because of course gender equality is connected with a lot of things of economic development, urbanization. When you control for a lot of those conditions, it does appear that societies where there's greater gender inequality have lower carbon dioxide emissions than other societies. I don't think there's obviously a singular direct causal mechanism going on there, mm-hmm. but it does suggest that part of what drives resource consumption in excess has to do with inequalities of power and decisions that influence people differently. So it's often noted, environmental threats disproportionately affect people with lower power. People with more wealth can avoid pollution, they can avoid the problems to deal with it. If you have greater equality, it's sort of hard to put those problems on someone else. And I think then societies make different kinds of decisions. So in that sense, it's not a simple causal link. It's saying something to do with processes of equality, gender equality being in some sense an indicator of other types of equality, affect how we make decisions in general about social trade-offs between how much we produce, consume, how much we pollute, who suffers the burden of that pollution.
So it would be reasonable to extrapolate from that that one of the things that we could be working for is more equitable societies, societies that are structured in such a way that more equity is available to more people.
Yes, I mean, I think that's exactly what I would say, that I think environmental sustainability and social equality and justice go together well. They're not necessarily, one does not necessarily determine the other. I can imagine having, you know, slippage between the two, but I think they go together well. I think that's, and if you think about that just in a literal sense, the huge inequality we have of income, that a very large share of the world's resource consumption and pollution goes to actually provide for a very small percentage of the world, right? So in just some obvious sense, if you didn't have this extreme consumption in some small groups of people, you could really scale back a lot of our resource use without harming most people, and in fact, potentially greatly improving circumstances for most people.
So people who have tend not to want to give up what they have. Have you studied that? I mean, this all sounds compelling. How do we get people to think in these new ways?
That's always the challenge. I often say, and sort of try to be honest, I'm much better at looking at problems than solutions, right? Because the problems are there, they're easy to study. I think it does, though, make, I think we often want to simply find win-win situations. And that's great. When you can find win-win, of course you should do that. But I think we also have to acknowledge there are genuine political tensions. There really are differences of interest and power. And that means that problems like environmental problems and social inequality are political struggles. That's awkward. It means they're not easy. But hence coming back to the issue of, I think we dodge that by thinking of this as a technological problem. We need to take that head on and recognize there are some difficult challenges here, and they do require political struggle.
Obviously, you're of the opinion that the research that you do contributes to this project.
I hope so.
You hope so. Can you say a little bit about, I mean, has any of the research you've been involved with been implemented in any policy kind of context?
I certainly couldn't say directly. I mean, I would like to think that intellectual work does have an influence out there. And I certainly have been on various advisory boards and you know, connected to some political actions in a broad sense. I'm sometimes depressed about how little people in power and government are affected by by scholarship. And some, you know, some, I think we often see that in Washington D.C. or policy efforts. They are surprisingly uninformed about research. So maybe in some ways I'd say I'm sad to say I don't know if it's been very effective.
Another of your research interests is the study of animals and society. So I understand that this kind of sociological research on animals and on the human-animal relation, that's a relatively new field, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
So it's interesting, broadly across disciplines, so not just in sociology, in the past decade or so, there has been a rise in interest of looking at societal animal interactions. And so in some sense, the sociology part is part of this broader animal studies movement. And I think that has multiple dimensions. So in one interesting and obvious sense, actually in our lives, we interact with a lot of animals. So in some sense, in an immediate sense, many people have domestic animal companions. Most very large share of people eat animals or rely on animals for food or other resources. So in some sense, animals are both an immediate companionship sense, a resource sense of societies, And of course, they have a lot of symbolic meaning. And I think you're probably more familiar in the humanities, a lot of animals have a lot of symbolic weight mm-hmm. to them. Mm-hmm. So animal studies is kind of aimed at looking at all those dimensions of how very much how we define ourselves as humans and how we material live as societies, somehow connected with a whole bunch of variety of animals, specific animals, and constructs of animals. The part there I'm interested in is probably you could see linked to my more interest in the environment is recognizing that our relationships with animals have huge, in a sense, animals are part of the environment. We use the environment as this broad term. Mm-hmm. So both our effects on the environment, on biodiversity, on wildlife, but also the consequences of our industrial agriculture. Reliance on meat production is highly connected with a lot of environmental problems. So that's probably more where my interest comes in. With also a broader interest in how animals have affected the development of societies over long stretches of time. I think we often kind of neglect the material bases and the animal bases of how societies change.
So how, prior to this new shift, in this new interest in animal studies, how were we thinking about animals and how are people like you thinking about animals now?
So in an academic sense, I think the truth is most sociologists, social scientists, probably weren't thinking about animals much. Uh-huh. And I think when...
They're thinking about people.
They're thinking about people. Like yeah. I said, it's just not in the mm-hmm. purview, or if they were thought about, it'd be purely in the symbolic element of it. They'd be kind of neglected. I think in societies, we tend to have a human-centric agency that everything that happens in the world is because of things we think and do, without it recognizing humans are embedded in ecological contexts and we are affected by these things. So I think that's part of the conceptual shift, is not just to see we make all of these decisions and everything else flows through our world that we make. That actually feeds back on us and affects how we live our lives. I think it's also to raise that, like environmental issues, there are also ethical implications here. Mm. A lot of people who do animal studies are concerned about the ethical implications of our interactions with animals.
And my understanding is that we've come to understand that animals' consciousness, and therefore the whole question of ethics, mm-hmm. we've gotten a much more sophisticated sense of the consciousness of animals, and also we've come to understand that their consciousness is much more sophisticated than we thought it was.
I think absolutely. I mean, I think in that sense is product of a lot of biology, evolutionary thinking, we are animals, you know, we are connected with it. We are part of the natural world, we're not just connected with it. We're animals. And so in some sense, there's not necessarily on everything a categorical divide between us and other creatures. And I think that is a broader interest. And I think that's part of like the post-humanities or mm-hmm. new humanities, that how do we define human? How expansive is that? Mm-hmm. And there's not neat, you know, and that's, I think, over the past 5 decades, you know, they found, for example, quite a number of animals use tools or make tools. These are things people didn't think. So a lot of things that we traditionally saw as strictly human seem to not be, and that's kind of changing. It's giving us more gray area to interpret.
So among other things, you are the head of environmental studies at the University of Oregon. Tell us a little bit about the environmental studies program. What happens there? Who does it involve? What do you teach? What goes on there?
So I would say the environmental studies program here is extremely strong, and I'm really lucky to have great colleagues, and we have excellent students, graduate students and undergraduates. The idea of the environmental studies program is it's strongly interdisciplinary. So we bring together faculty and students who don't fit necessarily into singular disciplines, who want to do work that crosses social sciences, natural sciences, and the humanities. And actually, I should say beyond that, we often engage, now it's seen as professional schools, architecture, we want to make more links with law, education. So it's to recognize that, of course, societies and environments, the world does not exist in disciplines. And if I want to know something about people and the environment, that's a huge range of things. It's not a neat category. And I think that's the recognition of environmental studies, is we need that breadth. So we have a body of core faculty members. Almost all of them have a joint appointment with us and another unit. A lot of them, I should actually note, are strictly speaking purely in another department, mm-hmm. but give their time. So we rely on a lot of generosity of people. And those connections vary. So there's some of them teach for us, some of them more take part in governments and community. Our students, we really encourage to make connections across units. So I think that is a lot of what we see as our mission, is bringing together a lot of different groups of people, and that would be maybe our most shared value is this interdisciplinarity. But I also think that gives this nice ethos of, I think, people in environmental studies are actually open-minded and used to being challenged. I think is most academics know we tend to end up on our own bunkers. Mm-hmm. And I think there's this ethos of, let's be challenged. Let's have the philosophers talk to the biologists. And that leads to really interesting conversations.
Oh, yeah, and I think it's not very common at the university that you actually have a room that has philosophers, biologists, sociologists, English professors sitting in the same room together.
Absolutely not. No, and that's what's fascinating about our meetings. When you discuss topics and you hear the huge, it really does give some perspective to our own, how we can all fall into narrow little realms. Mm-hmm.
That's very cool. You're also a teacher.
Yes.
Tell us some about your teaching. What are you teaching these days?
So, I'm currently teaching the graduate class on contemporary sociological theory in sociology, which I really enjoy. I mean, I have some great students, and that's fun because you get to cover a lot of the big ideas. You know, it's that because it's the first year students, it's what are we trying to do with theory? What does it mean to explain things? How do you understand things? What is society? So you got to, in a way, deal with both big epistemological questions like the nature of science and research and scholarship and all these challenges in society of power and inequalities. So I have a lot of fun with that class, and I really enjoy that. I also have teach graduate classes on environmental sociology, undergraduate classes. I should also say I've regularly taught the undergraduate statistics class, which is actually one of the classes I really like teaching. I should say it's not a thing that people think about, but I've always thought statistics is fun because it's, I think of it in a broader philosophical sense of, it's how do we answer questions about the world? How do we get knowledge? What does it mean to have theories, to develop them, to examine them? So. I do actually in all my classes I kind of enjoy all the aspects of them, even parts that are often not seen as kind of that exciting.
Do you have the opportunity to bring your own research into the classrooms, and particularly the undergrad classroom? Does that ever happen?
I certainly I mean, my graduate classes, yeah, I have a lot of my own work can be part of that. And in my undergraduate classes, I do bring in some of my own research. I try, you know, you don't want to be narcissistic and have your classes.
Well, you may not want to, but some people don't seem to mind.
Well, you know, we all give an occasion. So I have assigned occasionally my own articles, and I think that's important so people are engaged with what's going on here. It's not just some, you know, distant person who wrote a book who's not there. Mm-hmm. I do try and do that. And I like my statistics, I've used examples of my, because I have my own data, it's easy to use these as illustrations. Mm-hmm. And I do think that's an important part of education, to show how these things actually happen. I think one of the problems often with education is it seems the things we know seem so removed. They're taught we just know these things, mm-hmm. as opposed to saying, here's how we find out things. Here's mm-hmm. how this process of research works, how we learn, how we ask questions.
Do you have any new research projects that you're working on that you could tell us about?
Well, I always have kind of multiple things going.
Tell us about one or two.
So one thing I just have kind of been extending on a part of work is it's actually statistical, but more conceptual. It's what I call it asymmetry in modeling techniques. And this has to do with how growth can be different than decline. And I'm thinking here in issues like for environment, economic growth and economic decline are not symmetrical necessarily, meaning they might be qualitatively different. So on modeling things like what happens when you get economic growth to energy use, what happens to energy use when the economy declines, the standard modeling approach assumes that there's symmetry. If you go down one unit, it pulls it down as much as it pushes it up with going one up. And actually, that's not necessarily the case. And I've actually done research showing that that's not the case with energy resources. And I've been trying to generalize those techniques. So it's both a substantive interest I have in looking at the effect of economic change on environmental outcomes, but then also a conceptual way of how do we actually model that, because that's not really standardly done in statistical modeling.
Can you give me a specific example of how that works?
Yeah. So, for example, it generally is the case that economic growth pushes up energy use. Mm-hmm. Economic decline does not pull it down nearly as much. Hmm. And so even though it does pull it down and suppresses it. So you can actually get this interesting ratcheting effect where if you have economic growth, it pushes it up, and then you've got a recession, it doesn't pull it down as much, and then you have growth, it pushes it up again. I think the reason for that is what I call infrastructural momentum. Is in periods of growth, you build new infrastructure, you build roads, freeways, you build power plants, and so forth. With economic decline, those don't go away. And so they're kind of stuck there. Those things are harder. You know, you buy a car just because your money's low, you still tend to use your car. So I think you get kind of this structural additions with growth. I think there could be many different reasons for that. But so I'm interested more in that general, than also thinking about that general concept across other areas of sociology.
So assuming that you can generalize and demonstrate this as a general principle, how might that be helpful across sociology, for example?
I mean, I think in some specific way, it would let us, in a technical sense, would let us model things better. But I would say what it means also is it tells us history matters. In some ways, I think we tend to think you have a condition. It says X predicts Y. You have a condition X, it predicts some outcome Y. So you know, how much your GDP is, how much energy you use. If the pattern of growth and decline matters, it actually says you need to think about the history of how things became the way they are. So I like the way it opens up a deeper conceptual issue of how we think about processes beyond the simple statistical modeling part of it.
Have you had any success persuading people to look deeply at history when contemplating these questions?
I like to think we've moved there. I mean, I've certainly published a thing or two and have convinced a few reviewers and gotten some people interested to look at it. So I think those are a step at a time.
So, I mean, we're just about out of time, and have you, I know you're a person who does thought experiments, you've shared a thought experiment with us, I assume you do thought experiments in your classes, have you tried to do a thought experiment where you would imagine the structure of a society where we would be in a kind of condition of sustainability and not perpetual growth? What does that look like?
Yeah, no, that's always a... That's the big challenge. But no, actually, I think it is the, and I don't have some, romantic hope that everything will work out simply, but I don't think that it is in our nature to want more and more stuff. I think that is an artificial contrivance of the modern capitalist era. I think so some study would be where we put our time and energy into human relationships, into trying to improve people's quality of life, rather than expansion. That doesn't mean, as some people would say, freezing in the dark. It doesn't mean, of course, we have some basic material needs, but I think we could have quite rich and fulfilling lives without large houses, high energy use. And I don't think that in that sense, I don't think moving toward environmental sustainability is a sacrifice, as it's often portrayed. It actually could be a way of developing richer quality of life. And part of that would be require addressing issues of inequality. So I think it would certainly improve a lot of people's quality of life, even though it might challenge the power of a few of the 1%.
Well, I thank you very much. That's a wonderful note on which to end. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Richard, for talking with us today.
Thank you, Paul. I'm glad to have been here.
I've been speaking with Richard York, professor of sociology and environmental studies at the University of Oregon. Thank you so much for watching.